I do want to make a plug for our MBSF family get-together, friends and alumni of MBSF next weekend, next Saturday at noon right here. Hope you can come, have a good time, catch up with folks. I've had several people send emails, and so planning to be here. Probably get a few more this week, hopefully, but y'all plan to attend. I'm going to have some barbecue. Hopefully it's good. And so if it's not, then I'm sorry. But anyhow, y'all come on and have a good time. All right. This morning, 1 Thessalonians 4:16, it says, "For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, and with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first." For 2,000 years, Christians have been watching and waiting for the return of the Lord. Even though we don't know all the details of what that's going to look like, we know with certainty that when Christ returns, we will be with him forever. So Christians are not to grieve like the rest of the world who have no hope. Instead, the second coming of Jesus gives us great hope. He is our hope. And the promise of that return, that we know that whether we live or die, that we will be with the Lord forever. And so live in that hope of Jesus Christ. Live in the hope of the salvation that he has provided by shedding his blood and being raised from the grave. So watch, listen, hope, and desire for that time when Christ returns, when the archangel shouts and the trumpet of God sounds, and Christ will descend from heaven, and we will be with him face to face for eternity. It'll be a glorious day. It is our hope. So live in that hope of Jesus Christ. Father in heaven, we thank you for your Son and for that hope that we have, and that we look for that glorious day. We long to hear the shout of the angel. We long to hear that trumpet sound to know that our Savior, our Lord, is coming and that we will be with him forever. And I pray that we will be diligent in the work that's before us to share that good news of Jesus Christ to those who are dying. God, I ask that you forgive us where we fail you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning, everyone. This morning, I will be the MBSF group. There's a lot of sickness and stuff going around, so it's just me. But if you could, please stand, and we'll sing some songs this morning. My hope is built Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but only trust in Jesus' name. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood. High and stormy gale, My anchor holds within the veil. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is the storm, Lord of all. He is Lord, Lord of all. When He shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in Him be found, dressed in His righteousness alone, faultless to stand before. You may be seated. Thank you. This one is a newer song, but I really like the words of it. So if you could please sing it this morning. If not, just listen to the words.
Alone in my sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope and no place to was redeemed, only beauty remains, and my orphan heart was given a name. My mourning grew quiet, my fear rose to dance, when death was arrested and my life began. Oh, Your grace, oh, washes over me. You have made me new. Now life begins with You. Released from my chain, I'm a prisoner no more. My shame was ransomed, He faithfully bore. Your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new. Now life begins with You. Our Savior displayed on a criminal's cross, and darkness rejoices, no heaven is on. But then Jesus arose with our freedom in Him. That's when death was arrested and my life began. That's when death was arrested and my life began.
Good for our last song. Let's go ahead and stand and sing How Great Thou Art. Oh Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the world thy hands have made, I see the stars. Throughout the universe display, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Father, thank you for this day, and thank you for allowing us to be in your house this morning to worship you and to grow closer to you as we learn from your word. Lord, be with the remainder of this service that we will grow closer to you and learn what you want us to learn, Lord. God, be with this offering that it will be a blessing to this church and be a blessing to you. Lord, forgive us of where we fail you, and I ask these things in your name. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you. This morning I'll be singing a song that I wrote as my special.
Your love is like an ocean, it's always still, even when the storms are rough. Your love is ever faithful, it's always there, even when I've lost myself. 'Cause you are my God, you are everything, you are my God, you are my God, you are everything, you are my God. Your love is forgiveness, even when I've sinned and lost my ways. Your love goes on forever, ever renewing all my days. 'Cause you are my God, you are everything. You are my God, you are my God, you are everything, you are my God, you are my God. Because you are my God, you are everything. You are my God, you are my God, you are everything, you are my God, you are my God.
A young man ought not be able to sing that high. Let's open our Bibles to Matthew chapter 25, if you would. Let's continue our study on parables. This one has been titled The Parable of the Ten Virgins, or Those with Little Lamps. you title it however you want. But we'll be in chapter 25 of the book of Matthew. We'll be reading the first 13 verses. When you find that, would you stand to your feet, please, if you're able? Then shall the kingdom of heaven be likened unto 10 virgins, which took their lamps and went forth to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were wise, and 5 were foolish. They that were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them. But the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. While the bridegroom tarried, they all slumbered and slept. And at midnight there was a cry made, "Behold, the bridegroom cometh. Go ye out to meet him." Then all those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. And the foolish said unto the wise, "Give us of your oil, for our lamps are gone out." But the wise answered, saying, "Not so, lest there be not enough for us and you. But go ye rather to them that sell and buy for yourselves." And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came, and they that were ready went in with him to the marriage, and the door was shut. Afterward came also the other virgins, saying, "Lord, Lord, open to us." But he answered and said, "Verily I say unto you, I know you not. Watch therefore, for ye know neither the day nor the hour wherein the Son of Man cometh." Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we look forward to the day of the return of Christ. We look forward to that day with anticipation and with hope. But Lord, we want to not only have that in our mind, but we want to live as though we know that fact to be true. Lord, we know that you have prophecy before us that we can understand and know the future. You've told us exactly what will happen. And Lord, we know that your return is coming. Lord, we want to be prepared and we want to live lives as though we are practically understanding the truth of this fact. Lord, we ask you to be with our services this morning. May you receive all honor and glory. We thank you, Lord, for the experience we've already had in getting to worship you, and we pray that that worship continue. May our hearts be brought low and your name be exalted, and it's in your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. This particular parable gets all kinds of different ideas about it. Some want to attribute the foolish to this specific ethnicity or this specific group, and the wise ones as this specific group. And of course, anybody who tells the tale, they wind up in the wise group themselves. And so that ought to be the trigger right there to understand that some people have some ulterior motives when they go trying to make this fit into their theological box. But let's try to put this in the context of when Jesus speaks this. In Matthew 24 and 25, he's got his disciples there with him, and he is speaking of eschatological times, end time events. He's saying, here's what will happen at the end. There's going to be a return by me. I've got to go somewhere. Now, this is not the first time he's told them this. This is, as a matter of fact, has been several occasions he has spoken to them about his death and that he is leaving. He does this at the end of John chapter 13. He expresses to them, "I am going away." And they're concerned, "Why in the world would you leave us?" And that's when we get John chapter 14 that is so popular to us. "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions." That whole thing that we read, and I think we take it out of context too. The description he's given them is, "Don't be afraid. I've got to go. This is how this is going to happen. But let me assure you, I am coming again to receive you unto myself." See, we forget that part sometimes too. I think we get focused on that mansions, right? What's going to be for me, the selfishness of it? What's going to be available at my disposal? What's heaven going to be like? What is this place that's prepared? Let us focus on we will be with Jesus. I don't care what I get. I want all he's got to give, don't get me wrong. But whatever he's got to give, it's going to be great. I'm excited about that. It's going to be better than this life has ever even dreamed of offering. So I'm just excited to be there with the Lord. So in the context of chapter 24 and 25, he's got his disciples, and yet again he is saying, "I am going away, but Christ will return me. I'm coming back." Now, I don't think they ever got it, okay, as far as while he was here with them. I think even on the day of the cross, they felt defeated. I think even after the resurrection, there are times they are hiding because of the Jews, right? They're locked up because of the way they've been treated. They're still concerned. They're not even sure. They understand when Mary comes to them and says, "His body's gone. Somebody has stole it." It's still, the gears are turning, but they're turning awfully slow. And I know we give them a hard time, but I think we'd be in the same boat. Trying to understand how this is going to unfold for them. Put yourself in their shoes. We get to look back and read the history of it. We know when we say, "Oh, how foolish. Why don't they just read the book?" Well, they didn't have the book. We're privileged to know how it went down. I think we'd find ourselves in the same situation wondering how this is going to unfold. But he gives them this parable. speaking of his return. It's something they would understand. Marriages were a little bit different in that day than what we have here for us. We've got a little bit different culture. For them, they would have like stages. And we do as well, right? How many rings do you young ladies get nowadays, right? There's the promise ring, right? We don't count that anymore. And then you get the engagement ring. And then you get the wedding ring. And so I think the jewelers have swindled us, is what I think has happened. But we've got these different stages of the relationship. Well, for them, there was a betrothal. You've read about Mary and Joseph having been espoused, as the King James calls it. It was a time even legally binding. All right, the marriage is not official, but they are tied together as one legally. It would have required a divorce to be separated. But there's this waiting period that they want everybody to watch and evaluate that everything is as it should be. Waiting for that marriage. And when it come time for the ceremony, we've went over a parable that discussed a banquet that lasted several days. That they would have this ceremony that continued a week long, a giant ordeal. But when it come time for this big banquet, the groom was to be preparing that at his house, ready to accept his bride. And she would not know when it was going to be ready. She just needed to be ready for when he came to get her. She's going to be ushered to the new place. Now don't get in your mind that, my goodness, he's got 10 wives lined up. Why are there 10 virgins? This word was used in that time just to mean a woman of marrying age. We still do this in our custom, right? By the way, ladies, how many bridesmaids are you supposed to have? As many as I can find, preacher. Right? What is the number? What is the proper number? Well, there's really not one, right? We line them up, and we've got to have enough guys over there to match. And we've got all these things that society tells us this is what it should be. Well, what this is you've got a bride, and she's got some bridesmaids with her, okay? It's not a complicated setup. There's a bunch of young ladies here that are a part of a wedding ceremony, and they are going to be with the bride, waiting on the groom to come pick them up and take them to the feast. That's the situation they're in. They're waiting. We don't do it quite like that, do we? We've got a little bit too much West in us. But are there times that we have things that we want to be ready for and prepared for? We get ready to take a trip, and maybe we have a checklist or something. Maybe you're that type of person. You want a good list. You can check off everything. I'm trying to think of every situation we might possibly run into, right? Us guys, we're thinking now, if we have a flat, I've got a spare, and I've got this, and I've got that. Ladies, you're thinking now, if we have a flat, I'm going to need some snacks for these kiddos so we're not going crazy, right? So we get that packed away. For us, it's the diaper bag, right? We got to have that thing. It is essential. We got to have all these things packed up. Is everything, all the boxes have been checked? Do we do this for life concerning those who have given their life to Jesus? Do we have a checklist of life that I've accomplished these things because I am preparing for what is in front of me, the trip that's about to take place? And by the way, we're going to take a trip. Y'all ready to go? Let's just go in our mind's eye right now. I don't really know how it's going to go down, but I'm excited to be getting out of here. Okay? I don't have it all worked out in my mind. I don't even think he's given us all the details of how it's going to work out in our mind. But we can know we're leaving, and so shall we ever be with the Lord, and I'm excited about that. So let us check those things off. Now, ladies, tell me this. When a guy says, I am going to accomplish a task, I'll be outside, and you say to him, how long are you going to be? Well, he's going to say, oh, this job shouldn't take more than 15 or 20 minutes. That's always the case, right? He's always back in 15 or 20 minutes. No, later that night, as he comes walking back in, filthy, he says, that was a bigger job than I thought it was. Right? Not saying at all that Jesus doesn't know exactly what he's doing, but we are in the position that you ladies are in. We don't know when he's going to walk in the door. We've been given some hints. We've hollered a few times out the window, and we've heard back, it's coming soon, I'll be there in a little bit. Well, we've heard a few things. We know some prophecy that's going to be fulfilled, and we see that rolling out in our world today. And we just don't know when he's going to walk in, so we've got to be ready. We've got to have that checklist prepared. We've got to be on the ball, ready to go. So wisely prepare, because the groom is coming. There is no doubt about it. Who is the character in this particular parable? Jesus is speaking of his own return. The groom is coming. You need to be prepared. Let me assure you, if I know anything, I am a prophet in the sense of I can give some foretelling of what God is doing right now. Can I do foretelling as in way out there in the future? Only with what he's provided with us through his word. All right, I'm not a fortune teller. I can't predict how everything's going to work out. But God has provided to us some future knowledge. We know what is going to come to fruition. And let me assure you, he is going to return. The Apostle Paul himself thought it would happen in his lifetime in the first century. He said, we need to be ready. I have no doubt the disciples thought it would happen in their lifetime. I think when he's having those discussions after he's been resurrected and he says, now don't lay hands on me, don't cling to me, this is not the second coming. All right, I think they would have got that confused. Well, he's here once, now he's died, and he's here again. This must be the second coming. And he says, no, 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 I have not yet ascended to my Father. I'm going to go do that and prepare a place for you, and then I'll come back. Don't get confused. I am resurrected. Y'all, they saw him for 40 days after that resurrection. But that was not the second coming. We're going to get to see him forever. We look at that, and it seems as this distant thing because it has been so many years. Paul himself writes that there's going to be many say it's already come and gone. Peter writes this as well and says there's going to be those that tell you you've missed it. There's going to be those that tell you, well, it's already come and gone, or it's not happening because of the time that has continued on. I would have loved you. I wish you guys would tell me, those of you that were there, what it was like with Hitler's Germany. All right, here is a man trying to eliminate God's chosen people from the earth. All right, if anybody thought Antichrist was here, it was this guy, right? And yet it was not. Now, he is an Antichrist, but not the ultimate fulfillment that we look in the book of Revelation to see. The day is coming, a man much worse than that will come aboard. And we say, how can that possibly be? Well, let's look at the political status of the earth as it is today. Not just in our country, which, by the way, is crazy. Amen? Everybody on board with that? I don't care who you're voting for. What we got going on right now is nuts. And then the rest of the world is in political unrest. And you say, well, we're going to sign treaties and we're going to do this. Well, it'll be temporary. Has there ever been a time when we looked at the world and said, well, it's completely at peace? No, but there is coming a day. I know a guy who's going to rule with a rod of iron from Jerusalem for 1,000 years, and it's going to be peaceful or you're going to be in trouble. And just imagine the political unrest we have today and how much worse it could possibly get. People want to say, well, there are people that argue, well, we're in this millennium age today, that it's just a figure of speech, it's in a metaphor, and God's church are continuing to grow. They're taking over the world and peace is coming about. Y'all, I think we're devolving, not evolving. I look at it and say, I don't think things are getting better. I think we're getting worse. So what promise could we possibly have? Well, it's the one Brother Dale read about. It's that confident expectation. Not hope as in I wish, but my hope is in Jesus. Right? My hope is where it ought to be. I'm not worried about what's going on today. Okay? Do I have concern about the political unrest? Sure. Okay? Do I have concern that we don't have two people that can stand there and debate without ridiculing one another? Yes. Am I worried that somehow things are going to go bad? I'm not worried. I know who's still on the throne. I'm not worried. You know what? Even the people that get put in power, I know my God is in control of that. Even when it looks like, well, that person is so ungodly, how could God ever be a part of such a thing? God has done that before, used very ungodly men and women to accomplish his will. I'm not worried. The king is coming. The groom is coming. Here's what he says here to start his parable. Then shall the kingdom of heaven be likened to 10 virgins which took their lamps and went forth to meet the bridegroom. This is the situation we're in. We are waiting for the bridegroom to show up. The groom is on his way. We need to be prepared. We need to be where we need to be. We need to have the things necessary to accomplish to get us to that point. The event is coming. Are we prepared? Secondly, wisely prepare because the foolish will be left. You don't have to wonder, now which of these five done the right thing and which of these five did the bad thing. He says here, right here, there were five that knew what they were doing the right thing, and there were five that were foolish and didn't know what was going on. They didn't prepare. Lamps in those days required quite a bit of refill. They might make it out of clay. It might just be the size of your hand. Just kind of hold it in your hand like a cup. Right, and put a wick in it, and it would last for a certain amount of time. But you don't know how long it needs to last. You need to be able to extend that if necessary because of our lack of understanding of when it's going to be. Like I said, Paul thought it would be in his day, but he prepared that it may not be. I'd like to say it's going to be in my day. Wouldn't that be something, be preaching when the Lord returns? We'll be on this earth and be a part of that. Don't get me wrong. I'm fine with being the dead in Christ that rise first, but it'd be pretty cool to be here, right? Be preaching the word when the Lord comes back. It'd be awesome. But it may not be. It may be that, hey, we're all long gone and we've got another millennium to go. We don't know. But God does. So we're in this state of waiting, and we've got to sit and think, it may not be in my life. I'm not going to live my life as if he's coming back in a year and just going to go crazy, but I am going to live my life as if he might come back in a year because I don't know. I'm going to live for Christ every day knowing his return is coming, and I'm going to be prepared when it is. What situation do you want to be in when he shows up? Do you want to be worried? Do you want to be in a situation that I can't believe my Savior caught me in this one? Where do you want to be in life? What about your spiritual maturity? Where do you want that to be when the Lord comes back? Here's what these young ladies did. Five of them were wise and five were foolish. They that were foolish, they took their lamps and took no oil with them. They're not prepared for a lengthy stay. They're not prepared should this turn into a long endeavor. They're thinking, well, this is going to happen quick. I have an understanding of how this is going to go, so I'm not really going to prepare. I'm just going to do what I need to do right now, and, I'll deal with the rest later. But the wise, they took oil in their vessels with their lamps. It might become that my light will shine for only so long, and he may still have not arrived, and I need to prepare. While the bridegroom tarried, they all slumbered and slept. They just said, well, okay, he's not here yet. At midnight, there was a cry made. Behold, the bridegroom comes. Go ye out to meet him. How bright is it midnight? It's pretty dark. I'm going to need a light. Those that fell asleep probably left their candles burning, run out of oil. Not available to run out. The groom shows up at midnight. What a crazy time. Why would he do such a thing? Why now? You've never been guilty of saying that, have you? Well, they picked a bad time to do this. I can't believe I'm not ready. Are you going to do that when the Lord returns? Lord, I'm not ready right now. Let me get something on. Let me get prepared. See, he also described that there would be some working in the field. There would be two women in the kitchen, one go and one stay. Some would have, it would be the middle of the night. Some would be the middle of the day. Everybody would be in different situations at different times. Are you really going to look at the Lord and say, this is a bad time? Come back later. I don't want to be caught in that situation. I want to be ready. Then all the virgins arose. They woke up after the cries made, trimmed their lamps. Okay, we had some excess. We got it trimmed up. It's ready to burn bright. Now we're ready. The foolish said unto the wise, give us your oil, for our lamps are gone out. Everybody's is out, but the five wise came prepared for such a situation. They're ready. The Lord shows up. I want to be able to say, hey, grace is ready. Let's go. We're where we need to be. And how do we stay that way? Every day, all day. We're ready, looking forward to it. I don't ever want us in a situation where I say, Lord, you know what? We've got some things we need to get right. We're not really prepared for you yet. We always need to be ready to say, Lord, let's go. I'm ready to go. As individuals, I know we long for the place and we're ready to go, but are we really prepared? Are our hearts where they need to be? Where are our hearts? Maybe it's in the material possessions you've gained over this lifetime. Are you going to be sad to see them go? Let me assure you, you don't have anything that important. Oh, preacher, you don't know. I've got some priceless possessions. They're going to burn up with a fervent heat. They're going to disappear. Sorry. I have them too, but I don't dare value them as much as I do my salvation in Jesus. Why would your heart be in such a place? Do you remember Jesus speaking with the rich young ruler? He came to Jesus and said, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus said, well, have you kept the commandments? And he said, I have. Yeah, right. I've kept them all. And Jesus said, okay, then go sell all your possessions. Let's see where your heart is. Go sell all your possessions and give to the needy. And the young ruler left upset because he had many possessions. Now, he wasn't telling the rich young ruler he needed to work for his salvation. He was just revealing where the guy's heart was. And he was laying up treasures here. Don't do that. Don't lay up your treasures here on this planet. All right? Go out, do the best you can. Try to be successful as we describe it. Okay? Go out and live, but do so in a manner that is pleasing to God. I assure you there's more blessings there. Have you ever wondered why it is the person with all the money in the world and everything they could possibly dream of material-wise wind up committing suicide? Why is that? Why do they battle depression? Some of us, we sit and think, well, you know, I don't get me wrong, I'd love to try it. I'd love to be a millionaire and try to survive. Okay, give me an opportunity. I think I could do it. But do you understand I've already got a foundation of where my mind needs to be and where my heart is, that it would just be money. All right? I like that Brother Jeff does such a good job organizing our finances here at Grace, but y'all, it's just money. Okay? It's just money. If we need to show up here and we don't have enough money to pay the electric bill, do you know we can worship God in the dark? We'll shine some headlights through the back door. We'll meet out front only during the daytime. Y'all know that's been done before. For those of you under, you know, my age and younger, at one time electricity wasn't around. And people worshiped God. They didn't have a Bible app on their phone. They didn't have the printed word in their hand. And they worshiped God. All these amenities that have come along, these resources, they're great. But let's put them where they really are. And they're just over here is nice and handy. They're not Jesus. We can do without them. It's been done before. I think we get caught up sometimes in our possessions, worried about this life. And sure, we should plan for the future. Be wise with what you have, with what God has given you. But don't be so foolish as to say, this is what I'm about, my stuff. Because that's simply all it is stuff. And let's not do that as a church either. Let's be wise with what God has given us. Let's be good stewards of the things He's provided. But it is just stuff. It ain't Jesus. The wise answered and said, not so. We're not giving you any of our oil, lest there be not enough for us and you. Listen, we made the decision. We get the reward of it. You make a decision to live for Christ, you get the reward of it. You can't transfer that to somebody else as much as we'd long to with family members and things. The decision is yours. You're going to be prepared or not. You're going to be wise or foolish. Your decision as an individual. Lest there be not enough for us and you. Go rather to them that sell and buy for yourselves. Hey, go take care of this. But if it's going to take a long time, if you're going to continue to put it off, you're not going to be prepared when the groom comes. Satan's biggest lie is not that you need to deny Jesus. It's that you've got plenty of time to do it later. He's not going to be so opposed to it that it turns you off completely. He's just going to convince you, no, just procrastinate a little. You've got time. You've got your entire life to live. Have some fun now, right? This is his lie. Have some fun now, and you can do that religious stuff later. Now, I'm not the coolest guy at the party by any means, but we have some fun even in Christ, don't we? Isn't there some joy that can be found even in Jesus? Matter of fact, I'd argue that ours is better. That other stuff is temporal. It's going to give you this high for a season, but you know what you're going to need after that? Another high and another high. And with Jesus, we just get to stay up here. No matter what circumstances change in our life, we're always prepared because we got Jesus where he ought to be in our lives. Go, sell, or excuse me, buy for yourselves. And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came. They that were ready went in with him to the marriage. Oh, I look forward to that. Well, I'm ready. The Lord comes back. We're ready. Let's do it. Let's see what this is like. Let's see what it means that with a shout we'll be caught up in the air with him. Let's see what it means to rule and reign with Christ 1,000 years. Y'all are in adult classes getting to study the book of Revelation. It's going to be a wonderful trip into the things you don't understand. Right? We want to tackle that book so bad and come to these wonderful conclusions that nobody has concluded in the last 2,000 years. And yet we think we're going to find this nugget of information. The beauty of it is that Jesus is coming. John, after all that talk, gets over there to chapter 22 and he says, "Even so, come, Lord Jesus." All the rest of that is just details. Let us talk about what's going on. This is the revelation of Jesus Christ. This is the revealing of the Son to us. No longer will it be, well, I talk to God through His Spirit. No longer will it be, I need to pray with an intercessor to the Father. We shall be in the presence of Jesus, face to face. I'll look at Him. I'll look upon Him. I'll bow down in front of Him and say, finally, we have been vindicated. Finally, the world can quit laughing at us. Finally, the world will no longer say, oh, this isn't going to happen. That's a fairy tale, and that's all just religious garb. Instead, we'll say, look. I'm excited for that. We're ready. The groom comes. We enter into the marriage with him. All right. That relationship, incredible. Never before been done, and all God's people get it at the same time. Wow. Afterward came also the other ones, the foolish, saying, Lord, Lord, open to us. We weren't ready. We weren't prepared. We didn't make good decisions. We didn't listen. Lord, let us in too. And you say, well, he's a God of love. Of course, he'll forgive and allow everybody to go to heaven. But see, that's not what he said. He said, I'm a God of love. I have supplied the ticket to anybody who wants it. I am a God of love. I have sent my only Son, the firstborn, the only begotten, the unique one. That's how much I love. But there will not be a way out apart from his Son. There will not be a pathway. You won't get to say, oh, but I wasn't ready. I needed to go prepare something else. Oh, I didn't make a good decision. I'm not prepared. Please come back another time. I want to put this off to the last minute, and all of a sudden the last minute has come and gone. Y'all know about that change that takes place in 1 Corinthians 15? You know, that this mortal body must put on immortality. How fast does that change take place? Paul describes it as in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. Quicker than that snap. Well, what about the Lord's return? I'll wait till I hear the trumpet and then I'll prepare. No. I'm going to put this off until the end of my life. I'll do it on my deathbed. You may not get one. I can remember as an 8-year-old boy being convicted. You know, we've been in those situations. We felt the preacher was preaching right to us. I got that one Sunday morning. I hopped in the van with Mom and Dad and got to asking about this salvation stuff. You know, their ears perked up, ready to discuss it. You know, here their son wants to know more about Jesus. And Dad told me about it. And I said, well, I'm going to wait till I'm 9. I was 8. And I said, I'm going to wait till I'm 9. You know, I think I'll understand better then. And I'll never forget his word. He said, it don't work like that. Which is not what I wanted to hear. Tell me it's okay I put this off. And I didn't. Next Sunday, walked that aisle, cried like a baby. Finally give in. But I thought, I'm going to put this off. I'm going to wait. But that's not the design. How many times are you going to be convicted? How many times is the Holy Spirit going to come to you with the pricking of the heart to receive Jesus into it? Hey, I'll promise you one. Bible says that. Do you think there are people that have been convicted that aren't convicted anymore because they've just completely shut him off? Now, I'm not going to say you ever went too far that God can't get you, but there are some hard-hearted people in this world that have said no a lot of times. Your opportunity may be right here, right now. This may be it. How many people we have known that have died instant deaths, whether their health has changed or it was some accident and just gone. You don't know. But the groom's coming. Let me also assure you, death is coming. Those that are foolish, they're going to get left. Here's what he answered in verse 12. He answered and said, verily, truly, I say unto you, I don't know who you are. There will be many in that day saying, Lord, Lord, I did these wonderful works in your name. I had good things going in my life. I was good. I was morally good. And he's going to say, depart from me, ye that work iniquity. I never knew you. Don't be foolish. Don't allow Satan to convince you, well, I'm a good person. Don't let Satan convince you, I've got plenty of time. Prepare now. Lastly, let's look at this. Wisely prepare. The timing is unknown. At the conclusion of this parable, Jesus is done speaking the story, and now he gives the lesson. He says, guys, look at me. Watch, ye therefore. You know the day nor the hour wherein the Son of Man comes. Wisely prepare. He's coming. Wisely prepare. The foolish are going to get left. And wisely prepare. You don't know when you need to be ready. Be ready all the time. Constantly ready. I'm in a situation where I want to be ready. Should it arrive midnight and I'm asleep, I can jump up and go in a good state. I want to be a part of the people that go. I want to be a part of the people that get to be with him forever. I want to be a part of that. I want to live that here on earth with among his people. Not seeing its ultimate fulfillment yet, but I want to have that joy and hope right now. In a world longing for it so much, this is the good news we have to offer. God offers forgiveness. God offers hope. God offers something that's much better than this life. God offers eternity. Life eternal. I don't know when that eternal life gets to start in a new body. But that salvation, it's going right now. You're looking at a guy who's never going to die. That may break your heart. I'm sorry. You're stuck with me for all eternity. Those people sitting next to you that have accepted Christ, hey, you better learn to love them. We got to do it for a long time. This is just practice. This is just the warm-up. This is just the layup drill before the game. This is just getting started. We don't even know yet the joys that can be found. But we've got some right now we can just taste, right? Some of my favorite verses are pulled out of context. It drives me crazy. Eye hath not seen, nor ear heard, neither hath it entered into the heart of man, the things that God has prepared for those that love him. Isn't that wonderful? So it gets preached, well, we just don't know. You know what the next verse says? But these things have been revealed to us by his Spirit. I get to know. How great thou art. We sang an acapella there a while ago. And y'all, we're going to get to do that forever. Those chills that crawled up your spine, we get to do that for eternity. With a whole lot more than just us. And by the way, it won't be, Lord, I know you can hear us, and we're going to pray. Instead, he'll be sitting right there. Wouldn't it be something to sit there and sing to him with him sitting right there? Wouldn't it be something to worship at his feet? Lay those crowns at his feet, those rewards that we've been given, but we know ultimately we wouldn't have had them if he didn't give them to us. Won't it be something to be in the presence of Almighty God? You better be prepared. The time's coming. It's coming. You better have everything checked off the list because it's coming. Stand with me and let's pray. Father, we're excited about the time we'll be in the presence with you. Lord, we're excited about a time we can look forward to. Lord, but we don't want to become so focused on that we forget about the job you've got for us right here, right now. And that's to tell others that this event is coming. We know you've given us walking papers. You've given us duties to accomplish. And we need to be about your business all the time, helping others prepare. But Lord, we know we can't do that if we're not prepared ourselves. So we'll start with us. We'll start as individuals. And then we'll do it as a church. And as a result of that, we pray our city and our community, just right here close around us, would know for a fact that your return is coming. We want to be ready. We want to be wise. Lord, help us to do so. Grant that wisdom to us that you promised you would give so liberally. Help us make those decisions in our lives that lead us where we need to go in your will. It's in your precious name we pray. Amen.
I hear.